Welcome back to Q&A. As we go to air tonight, Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern is meeting with Chinese President Xi Jinping at the end of her one-day visit to Beijing. She met with the President at the Great Hall of the People. These are the first pictures coming out of Beijing just a short time ago. And that meeting is still underway, so that's the opening gambit they usually let the media in for. Earlier, she met the Chinese Premier and discussed a range of issues, including undertaking to start another round of negotiations on the FTA upgrade and China's grand global infrastructure project known as the Belt and Road. Well, joining me now is Simon Draper, Executive Director of the Asia New Zealand Foundation. Simon, good to see you. Hi. What's your thoughts so far on what we're seeing here? First of all, she got the visit. Mm-hmm. That was significant. Is it sort of what you expected?
Yeah, I think New Zealand worked itself up into a bit of a lather about this visit. I think it's probably more important domestically than it is the fact that she's actually going. Relationships like these with China, there's a whole lot of strands to it. And in a way, we don't want our relationship with China just to hang on that personal connection. At the same time, symbolism counts. She's meeting with President Xi. I mean, that says a lot that she's got to meet with him, and also Premier Li, her counterpart. So I think, you know, out of this visit, there will be signals sent into the Chinese system about how they're feeling about New Zealand, and that will be important for how bureaucrats treat us.
She goes at a time when she's got great political capital after being widely praised globally for her response to the Christchurch shootings. Do you think that the Chinese will have obviously acknowledged that and appreciate that makes a bit of difference?
Yeah, I think it does. I mean, what I've heard so far is that reporting of our Prime Minister's visit across Asia, not just in China, but across Asia, has got a lot more pickup than normal. So yeah, I think there's no doubt the Chinese are smart and they will understand having Jacinda Ardern in Beijing at the moment. That's a good thing.
It's an opportunity too, isn't it, for her to just grab the reins a little bit tighter when it comes to foreign policy in regards to Winston Peters, because if we look at something like the Belt and Road Initiative, this grand vision that Xi Jinping has, for infrastructure projects all around the place, including down our neck of the woods. Now, Winston Peters initially was a bit cool on that idea, despite National saying they'd signed up to a memorandum of understanding. I see in the statement tonight they're saying they're going to pathway to sort of work on some of these projects. So is that perhaps just a signal that maybe she's asserting herself a little bit there?
Well, the way I would look at it is the Belt and Road, you know, it's a bit like China's moonshot. No one quite knows exactly what it means, but we know it's important for China. So I think what the Prime Minister's doing is signalling that New Zealand understands the importance for it, even if we don't quite understand
it. But it's an easy one to give to them, isn't it? It's less likely to upset America, for example. You know, they're not that keen on it than, say, Huawei.
Yeah, I think the Belt and Road is China sort of saying we're back. I think it's a political security move on their part, which uses economics. So it's a bit like the Marshall Plan after the Second World War that the US did. So I think that the Belt and Road is something that New Zealand's interested in, but we still don't quite know what it means and how we're going to fit into it. The China Council put out their report saying that we could be a link point between Asia and Latin America, that sort of thing. So, you know, I'm sure that there would have been a hard sell on the Belt and Road in Beijing. It's important to President Xi, therefore it's important to New Zealand.
So we give them a little bit of a nod because it might be harder for us to give them what they want on Huawei, right?
Well, I think the trick for the Prime Minister is she's going to have to explain that the decision-making process in New Zealand is one that she doesn't have a lot of control of. And that's a hard sell in China because that's not how China works, right? Yeah. But China is smart, it's mature, it understands these things. You know, if a New Zealand telecommunications company wanted to build the backbone in China, you can imagine the Chinese government would be asking lots of questions about that. So it's making the Chinese understand our process means she doesn't actually have a lot of influence in that at the moment.
Maybe the Chinese have got a reasonable gripe in the sense that our spies sort of seem to push back spark and then it came out via the stock exchange. So it was in terms of diplomacy, surely that was a big surprise that China didn't know was coming.
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm a big believer in the cock-up theory rather than the Machiavellian theory with these things. Yeah, I think, I don't think our GCSB sort of expected that spark would have to go to the market and tell them what had gone on. But I tend to believe that was more of a muck-up than
But how important is it to China that when it comes to this relationship, when we see this, that we don't surprise them with things? Because they don't like that much, do they?
No one likes surprises in their relationships. We don't like surprises. So, yeah, it would have been a nasty surprise. But, you know, the way I see it, our relationship with China for the last 20 or 30 years has basically been around how much can we sell you, you know, how much do we sell stuff. But it's matured now, and China's changed. You know, it's a big, significant power. It wants to be a great power, and it's going to have to manage these sorts of things. We're going to rub up against each other in a way that we haven't in the last 20 or 30 years. But they're smart, they'll get that, and we're going to have to navigate our way through it. So I think we just have to be cool heads, take our time, explain our position, and just, you know, take the relationship forward that way.
Do you see this upgrade of a free trade agreement actually ever happening?
Yeah, I've seen enough FTA agreements or trade agreements to know that they are mercurial things. They just when you think nothing's going to happen, something will happen. At the end of the day, though, China will be doing its maths. It will be doing its calculus. Is it in its interest to upgrade the FTA? When the maths come out that it is, then they'll move on it. But until that time, you know, that they will do it when it works for them best. When they have to balance off what their farmers want with what their consumers want, just like we do here in New Zealand. When the time is ready, China will move. But it's a bit like watching paint dry. You know, the harder you look, the longer it seems to take.
The thing we don't know yet, and because the Prime Minister hasn't emerged, and she will do a stand-up with New Zealand media at least, and will no doubt be asked about whether she raised concerns about human rights, in particular the Uyghur, the Muslim population. How important is it that she does that?
Yep.
And does it in the right way?
Well, I think New Zealanders can be pretty assured that she will raise it. She's raised it before, not least because of the political expectation here in New Zealand. But she'll raise it knowing, and the Chinese will know, part of the deal with these bilaterals is you don't then go and dissect them and tell everyone what you said. So she will raise it. The Chinese response is typically along the lines of, well, that's a domestic issue and don't interfere with domestic things. So I think people who are hopeful that our Prime Minister raising it is going to change the situation, you know, I think that's a long bow, but she will raise it.
And this is where Prime Ministers can get into trouble when they go on these trips, because they come out of these meetings and then they've got a bunch of tired journalists wanting to go hard with their old microphones, and they can get their language wrong. Yeah. And the language is critical, isn't it, with something like this?
Yeah, words count, words matter. And how she it will be interesting to see how she relays, how she raised human rights issue with the Chinese, but she will. But how the readout we get on it will be important.
Will it play in the domestic media in China? I mean, that won't get reported, will it?
You mean the Uyghur question or her visit?
No, I mean the visit gets reported, but they won't pick up on the Uyghur stuff. It's just a domestic audience and maybe some other countries around the world.
It's hard to tell. I don't know enough about the domestic media space there. I think one of the things you have with China is they have their formal media, but they are right across social media now. So how things will spread out on Weibo and other platforms like that, whether it gets discussed. But I think you're probably right, Corin. I doubt it will get much coverage.
One final question.
Sure.
Are we just too dependent on China now? Do we need to be working much harder to diversify so that, yes, they're an important trade relationship, but should they be 20% of our exports?
Well, I mean, there's two bits of that. One is New Zealand has history of having too many eggs in one basket. We learnt pretty painfully from
China.
We learnt from that. But also, governments don't trade. Companies do. You know, it's for companies to decide where they want to sell their product.
And the government can set the tone by these sorts of trips, can't they?
They can set the tone by these sorts of trips, but the Prime Minister has been to other places and, you know, as someone has said to me, Asia's a very big country. There are a lot of other parts of Asia. China is really important, but we see at the Asia New Zealand Foundation lots of other opportunities in other parts of Asia.
Simon Draper, thank you very much for your time on Q&A. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
From the Director, of course, of Asia New Zealand Foundation.